Hello, FB First. I'm Jonathan Murdoch, and this is your In the Know. Thursday, May 6th, is the National Day of Prayer, and we are hosting a special service to focus our hearts on God and imploring Him to bless and restore our country. Just to be clear, this is a Thursday night service at 7 p.m., and we will be replacing our normal Wednesday night midweek services this week. Students will join in a prayer with us as well. FB Kids will offer their normal midweek services, which are awesome as always, but on Thursday night at 7 p.m. instead of Wednesday as normal. Our country has many, many needs right now. Every answer starts with prayer. So join us Thursday night at 7 p.m. and let's get to work. Senior adults, Saturday, May 15th, is the Trailblazers Fish Fry. We will start at 5 p.m. here at the church. Pastor Frank wants to remind you to put it on your calendars and plan to be there. Be sure to invite a friend and come hungry. To register, you can call the church or visit the church website. Summer is approaching, and parents, be sure to sign your kids up for Vacation Bible School and Kids Camp. VBS is June 21st through the 25th, and Super Summer Kids Camp is July 13th through the 16th. You can register by clicking the link at fbfirst.com/children, or just email me for more information at jonathanmurdoch@fbfirst.com. And students, don't forget to sign up for your camp as well. Super Summer Student Camp is July 6th through the 10th. Spots are filling up soon, so apply at fbfirst.com/students and grab your spots today. If you would like to get involved in what God's doing here at FB First, we are having a ministry fair on May 23rd. There will be many options for you to check out the different volunteer teams and join the one that God has suited you for.
So when Pastor Josh came to me and said, Dan, do you want to volunteer for the youth group? Like everybody, I thought, sure, with all the extra time I have in my schedule, that sounds like a lot of fun. But he coaxed me into it a little bit. We prayed about it. And on Wednesday nights, you will find me volunteering with motion students, and I have to say, it has been a fantastic opportunity. I've really connected with the other leaders. I've got connected with students that I wouldn't normally get connected with even in Young Life, and I've been able to learn from them. They've been able to learn from me, and most importantly, it helps make the church smaller, and I feel more connected where sometimes it can be easy for me to feel like I'm just another face in the crowd.
Wow. That's amazing. Be sure you're there to join us on May 23rd. I'm Jonathan Murdoch, and this has been your In the Know.
Well, good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? Oh, good, 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 good. All right, well, would you mind standing up with us as we begin to worship today? If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice and the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom, saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light, day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know to stay right. When there's a better life, there's a better life. You got pain, He's a pain taker. Save it, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, believe it. If you receive it, you can feel it. Somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it. Somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it. Somebody testify.
So great to see you this morning. Thank you so much for joining us in worship. And today at 3 o'clock at Peters Point Beach, we want to let you guys know real quick, we are going to be having a beach baptism service. And we got a few people that are getting baptized. If you are interested in getting baptized and you haven't done that yet, I can't think of a better day, a better time, or a better place than Peters Point Beach at 3 o'clock this afternoon. So come on out and look for the church flag. We'll have a big banner flag there, and we'll all gather there at 3 o'clock for baptism. If you've already been baptized, then just go to the beach today and celebrate with some people, because it's going to be a beautiful day, and it's a beautiful thing to celebrate. We want to welcome each and every one of you here. If you are online, part of our online community, we want to welcome you as well. So glad. Each and every week, we see all over the world people logging in to our online services. Something that, you know, a little over a year ago, Satan thought he was going to do something to the American church, to the worldwide church. But what he didn't realize was that the Holy Spirit also had plans for that, and he was going to use it for his glory. And it's pretty awesome that here at FB First, not only, you know, we talked about one thing. I was at a conference a couple weeks ago, and they talked about being in position when it's time to make the right move. You know, a lot of times we know what to do, but we're not in position. But this church was already in position with our technology, with our streaming, with people on staff, our volunteer teams. And it is so awesome to see what God's doing each and every week through our online ministry. So if you're tuning in online, we're glad to have you. People in the house, we're glad to have you as well. If you're a guest with us, there's a connect card in the seat backs in front of you. You can fill that out. As you leave today, you'll see these blue boxes. Those are there for us as a church family. That's where we put our offerings in. For you, don't reach for your wallet. Just fill out a card out and put it in there so that we will know that you were here. You can also text Hello First to 97,000. Follow the texting prompts. You can give us some information. The pretty cool thing about that one is you're actually going to be talking to a real person on the other side of that text message. And if you have prayer requests or questions or anything like that, we would love to connect with you. Man, it is so good to be here today. Pastor Zach is kicking off a new series called Exodus, Never Forget. And I can't wait, because my second favorite character in Scripture is Moses. Because Moses is someone that God said, despite all of your insufficiencies, I'm going to give you a position of leadership. And even though you're going to fail, I'm going to be with you all the time. And I can relate to that. I don't know about you guys, but I can't wait to see where this series goes. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll get back into worship. Father, we love you. We thank you for your goodness. Thank you for everything that you do. Be with us now as we worship, as we open our hearts. Prepare us to hear your word and prepare us for your ministry and whatever it is that you've called us to do this week. We pray in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Got 'em on my knees again. Got 'em begging, please again. like the sound of a symphony to my ears. Like holy water on my skin.
So we've got one more song, but I wanted to say, after the last service last week, we had a choir sing with us last week, and they sounded so good. They sounded so good, and I loved hearing their voices. And I thought to myself, I cannot wait. I cannot wait to have them back. I cannot wait to have the choir again. But, you know, I thought to myself, we have a choir in here every single week. We have a choir in here every single week, and it starts all the way over there and includes every single person in this room. And it just, it makes my heart sing hearing you sing your praises to the Lord every single Sunday. And you are the choir every single week, and I absolutely love it. And I want to thank all of you so much for all the singing and all the praising that you do, because it makes a difference. It makes a difference to us, and I know he especially loves to hear it. So thank you.
There's a song in my soul, and I feel the summon in me. This I know for sure, that your love is like a flood, and your mercy never ending. I give my song to you. There's a joy in my soul, and it rises like the morning. This I know for sure, that your grace is enough, and your promise never breaking. I give my song to
to you.
All the good, goodness is like a well running over. Oh, my soul, it sings for you. All the good, goodness, I will love you forever. All my songs I sing for you. All my songs I sing.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you've placed a song inside each and every one of our hearts, Lord, and that song sings for you. It sings for your goodness and your greatness, your grace and your love. Lord, we're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for all that you do for us, all that you give us, Lord. And this morning, Lord, we ask that you prepare our hearts and prepare our minds to receive your word, receive your message, Lord. We're so thankful that we have the opportunity to be here. We're so thankful for these people, Lord. And we ask that you just help us remember that everything that we have, we only have because of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Second book of your Bible, Exodus chapter 1, if you'll find your place there. Exodus, the first chapter, is where we're going to be this morning. Let me encourage you. I don't know if there are any copies left, but we have this journaling Bible that we're making available to you as we go through books of the Bible. We're going to grab some of these just in case you want them. It has the scripture in the version that we're using on the left side, then it has a blank lined paper on the right, so you can take notes and just kind of help you. The idea is over the course of years together, we will build our own commentary, and you can put this and store it with each book of the Bible there in your own bookshelf. So those are $10. They're just made available to you back in the lobby. Go by and pick one of those up if you'd like one. I can't read my own handwriting well enough to do it, so it doesn't help me, but it might help you. So you check that out. So we're jumping into Exodus, one of the most recognizable stories in all the Bible. You've got movies like The Ten Commandments. Our kids grew up watching the Disney Prince of Egypt story. Gods and Kings. I haven't seen that one yet, but I'm told that that's the newest one out. And so we have all of these things that we're familiar with. So when you hear the word Exodus, or you think about the book of Exodus, what comes to your mind? Shout out a few things that come to your mind. Egypt, what else? Ten Commandments? Leaving? Plagues? Red Sea, that's the big one for me. Mount Sinai, somebody in the early service said Charleston Heston come to their mind. I love that part in the story where he holds the gun over his head and says, you can take this. Maybe that's a different thing. Anyway, so we're very familiar, and as Americans, what do we like to do? We like to get to the good part, right? We want to go straight to the big, you know, emphasis of the story. But sometimes in doing that, we skip over some powerful truths that are set, especially in these early verses and early chapters, that just set the context for this story. And many times, that's why, you know, we can't relate as much to Red Sea's parting. God did that a couple of times in the Bible. He split the Jordan one time, the Red Sea one time, but it's not typical. It's not like it's something that you can just name it and claim it kind of thing. If God wants to do that, God can do it. But it's not normative. So we tend to feel a little bit disconnected. I think it was Stephen Hawking who compared the stories of Genesis to adult fairy tales because he saw it so disjointed and disconnected from life as we know it. However, what I want to show you today is if you'll slow down and really chew on the truth, especially that are between those big events, you will find it eerily familiar. Take a moment and just get our cultural bearings. You have right now a great plague that has swept across our world that has killed over 150 million humans. And in some parts of our world, like India today, that rate continues to skyrocket. Our southern border has been labeled a crisis by President Biden. Issues of gender fluidity have affected everything from the definition of marriage to Little League baseball. Racial and ethnic controversies are in the news more today than they were in the 60s. With a shifting of the balance of the Supreme Court, abortion is now a raging issue once again. And right out of the chute, as Moses, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, pens the words of Exodus, we see that right out of the gate, he addresses partial birth abortion, racial turmoil, gender issues, government overreach, immigration issues, and the worst pandemic that's ever spread on planet Earth till this very day. I'm telling you, what you're going to read in this book is more relevant and up-to-date than anything you've seen on Twitter in the last 5 years. It is a remarkable book that you not only read, but it in turn reads you. So let's jump right into it. Notice, first of all, it began with a failed remembrance. Look at verse 1. These are the names of the sons of Israel who came out of Egypt with Jacob, each with his household: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun and Benjamin, Dan and Naphtali, Gad and Asher. All the descendants of Jacob were 70 persons. Joseph was already in Egypt. So those are the opening credits. This is the opening scene, focusing on the tribes of Israel. In Hebrew, the book begins with the conjunction and. It literally says, and these are the names. It's highly unorthodox to begin a work of literature with a conjunction, but Moses did just that. Why would he do such a thing? Well, very simply to emphasize the fact that it's virtually impossible to correctly understand Exodus without first grasping the storyline found in Genesis. This is a part of what is called the Pentateuch, or the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. These are the primary portion that's referred to as the law by Jesus. And these are penned by the person of Moses. The account begins with the story of creation, those long debated first three chapters. God creates the world in absolute perfection. Sin and rebellion are introduced through the first temptation and the fall. The subsequent chapters illustrate the curse of sin, man's complete, absolute inability to deal with sin on the human plane. We see that long and never-ending parade of death from Abel onward. We see God destroying the earth with a worldwide flood and one seemingly righteous man spared along with his family, Noah. Noah seems like he might be the one who will set right all that has gone wrong in the city of Eden. God had promised, once the curse was given, that the seed of the woman, the male offspring, would one day make everything right that had gone so wrong. So there was hope in the man of Noah. Noah leads his family to safety, and then as the flood subsides, the ark comes to rest on Mount Ararat. And there it seems like maybe this is the great redeemer that we've been waiting on, until we find that Noah, as soon as he's able, is drunk and humiliating himself in front of a perverted son. The force and the primary purpose of Genesis is found later in chapter 12 with the call of Abram. Abram, minding his own business in Ur of the Chaldees, is visited by God with a command and a glorious and grand promise. We see it in chapter 12. Listen to verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and from your father's house to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless you, and I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, in a sense, the rest of your Bible is a commentary on how God kept his promise to Abram. Everything else you read until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Great Commission to send the church into all the world to make and equip disciples, and then ultimately new heaven and new earth, is all ultimately how God fulfilled his promise to Abram through his offspring, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the key turning point in the biblical narrative. In his old age, God gives Abram a son. Then he blesses his son Isaac with a son named Jacob. Then things get really interesting as Jacob has 12 sons who become the 12 tribes of Israel. The book of Genesis concludes with an amazing story of God's providence as Joseph is sold into slavery, but then rises to become prime minister in the land of Egypt, and he saves not only Egypt from a great worldwide famine, but he also saves his people, the Hebrews, the Israelis. Genesis ends with a verse reminding us that the story's not over. Genesis 50, verse 24. And Joseph said to his brothers, I am about to die, but God will visit you and bring you up out of this land that he swore to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Verse 25, He says that he made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry my bones back from here. So Joseph is remembering the promise to his great-great-grandfather. He's remembering the promise to Abraham. God promised to Abraham to give him that land. Now you have all of Israel in Egypt. Joseph has saved them. He saved the nation. He's about to die. And he says, guys, the story's not over. One day, you're going to be sent back, because God's got to keep his promise. You're going to be sent back to the promised land. When you do, take my bones with you. Then we see that Egypt gives him the burial rites that were reserved for the most influential of the land, the pharaohs and the kings of the land. He's embalmed in a way that would preserve his body for millennia, and then taken back. He's to be taken back when they leave the land. So there they are, growing and flourishing in the land of Egypt. About 400 years will pass as generation after generation grows and spreads, and they are very fertile people in a very fertile land. And so they're flourishing in the land of Egypt. They're multiplying. They're becoming, they're working in concert with God. I mean, think about what God had said. God said to Abraham, I'm going to make your descendants as innumerable as the stars of the sky. And so you have all of these young Israeli couples saying, we're going to help God with that. We're going to have a lot of babies. We're going to work in concert with God. And so they're having little boys and little girls. They're running around everywhere. They're growing. They're becoming leaders. They're becoming landowners. And then Egypt is growing more and more fearful of this new nation that is being born. Then we read in chapter 1, verse 8, Now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He had forgotten. He didn't remember Joseph. Now, nobody in that generation knew Joseph personally, but he had forgotten the story. He had forgotten the history. All throughout the book of Exodus, you will see a repeated, often repeated command. Remember. Remember. There's things happening here. Let's put up some stones of remembrance. Let's make sure that there's some memorials. Remember. Let's have a meal. And around this meal, let's make sure that we tell the story of what happened. And you see in the New Testament, as the Lord Jesus Christ instituted communion for the church, and he said, do this in what? Remembrance. You got to remember. Every time you see someone baptized, you remember that another was dead, buried, and raised again. The ministry of remembrance is so important. Early in my ministry, I wanted to give something new and profound, something you've never seen before, something you couldn't have gotten out of a commentary every time I preached the word. But the older I get, the more I realize that the ministry of just reminding you of what you know to be true is so important. You must remember these things. Camp out on them. Mankind has always recognized the remarkable value of history. Early man developed an extremely accurate form of oral tradition and storytelling that captured a story, many believe, better than the written word did. Over the course of copying, the scribes could mess up words, but the storytelling was so accurate, passed down from generation to generation. Then with the advent of written language, history was speared with a point of a pen. In hopes that those who study history will not be doomed to repeat it. Writing, guarding, studying history has been the practice of great civilizations from early Egypt all the way through the British Empire. And it was marching onward until our current generation. According to the New York Times, fewer than half of the American teenagers who were asked basic history questions even knew when the Civil War was fought. 1 in 4 said Columbus sailed to the New World sometime after 1750. About a quarter of the teenagers were unable to correctly identify Hitler as Germany's chancellor in World War II, instead of identifying him as a munitions maker or an Austrian premier. And add to that a desire to erase history altogether in some sectors. Joseph had been an Egyptian national hero, but he was completely forgotten in 400 years. This new pharaoh did not see the descendants of Joseph and his countrymen as allies and friends, but rather as a potential slave labor force, and if not properly controlled, as a potential threat to national security. So it begins with a failed remembrance. Secondly, notice a forced reality. If we forget our history, whether in the recent decades or whether over the long haul of millennia, we are forced to do social experimentation, which is an attempt to prove hypothesis by creating little segments of history over and over and over again so that we can have some history, because we've forgotten the real history, we create some history to base evidence upon. And in our nation, primarily, this is being done in the areas where government has the most influence. The military, for example, has become, in many ways, dreadfully, a place of social experimentation. And it's a very dangerous thing that is taking place. We see in the following verses, the government attempts to force or shape reality. Progressively, Pharaoh will try to control the number of Hebrews born in Egypt, treating them more like an animal to be domesticated rather than a people that bear the image of Almighty God. Look with me at verse 10. Pharaoh says, "Come and let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply." So the idea is, what can we do so that there's always more of us and less of them? What can we do so that the Hebrews stay in a minority and we stay in the majority position? It says, lest they multiply, and if war breaks out, they will join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. Therefore, here's the plan. Therefore, let us set taskmasters over them to afflict them with heavy burdens. They built for Pharaoh store cities of Pithom and Ramses. So here's what we tend to miss by going to the good part. We tend to miss that all of this began with a policy change that was oppression for the purpose of suppression. It's a policy change where they're inflicting heavy burdens on an ethnic people group that would oppress them in order to suppress their birth rate. Isn't that interesting? We're going to control the number of Hebrews who are born by increasing their workload. Have you ever recognized a connection between the intimacy in your marriage and the busyness of your work? Egypt recognized it. And so they crank up the heat. They turn up the heat. And they're saying, if we can just get them working enough, they will quit loving one another. And as a result, their numbers will decrease. It's a social experiment. But we know that because of the next verse. Look at verse 12. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied. Remember, they had a promise from God. God said, I'm commanding you to be fruitful and multiply. I'm commanding you to fill the earth. I'm commanding you to become more numerous as descendants of Abram than the stars of the sky. So they're working in concert with God. They saw even their intimate relationships as working in concert with Almighty God and His command to fill the earth. So it says, the more they were oppressed, the more they were multiplied, the more they spread abroad. As numbers increase, you got to have more space. And the Egyptians were in dread of the people of Israel. So they ruthlessly made the people of Israel work as slaves. Okay, here is another policy change. Notice how subtle it was in the beginning. We're just going to, you know, do some infrastructure changes and assign people as taskmasters. But now it's nationalizing slavery. An ethnic people group is going to be brought into slavery. And it doesn't tell us if they were slaves to actual Egyptians or the nation as a whole. But it appears that this was a government-instituted form of slavery. It says in verse 14, "And they made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in all kinds of work in the field. And in all their work, they ruthlessly made them work as slaves." So he's making their lives bitter. Think back over your journey. Have you ever had the lamentable position of being at a workplace where your employer, it seems, got up in the morning and wondered how he could make or she could make your life more bitter? Some of you, you know, I think everybody needs one job like that, don't you? It makes you appreciate what you have. But I don't think any of us have tasted anything to the level of what the Hebrews are going through. They're trying to make these people hate living. Now, it's one thing for you to go through that, but can you imagine seeing your mother go through that, or your father go through that, or your grandparents go through that, to where the national government, it seems, is trying to make them despair of life? This is the world into which Moses was born. He saw a world where his biological mother and father, his countrymen, his cousins, were all being so ruthlessly oppressed that they despaired of living. And then in verse 15, "Then the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives," now these are medical professionals. These were single ladies who were comparable to the eunuchs, the men who didn't marry or have children. The midwives were given over to just the medical profession and helping to give safe labor and delivery practices. They were medical professionals. So the king of Egypt, this political leader, is talking to this medical sector of the population. And it says there were two in particular. They were the leaders. They were named Sisera and Pua. He says to them, "When you serve as midwife to the Hebrew women and you see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill him. But if it is a daughter, she shall live." Government-controlled health care. Pharaoh care, as it were. What an innovation. But it seems these midwives, they weren't reporting to a doctor who had sworn some sort of Hippocratic oath that looked out for the well-being of the patient above everything else. But now they were being expected to report to a political ruler whose main concerns were national security, guarding the borders. Now, when you go to the doctor, isn't that what you want your doctor worried about? Do you want him worried about politics, or do you want him worried about how to get you healthy and back to regular life? We want our doctors to honor their profession, to have a calling to where they're focused on bringing health to the human body. But here, it was becoming diluted. It was the politicians were speaking into the medical profession. Population control was the name of the game. I'm told that this past week, 750 million mosquitoes were released in Key West intentionally by the government in order to fight the mosquito population. It just sounds like a government idea, doesn't it? Well, the mosquitoes were sterile, and the offspring don't survive. Ultimately, it'll probably work. It's worked before. But I think any of us who, when we first hear that story, wherever you fall on the political spectrum, we get a little uneasy about that, don't we? Do you want them unleashing those in Nassau County? If we get concerned about them controlling the population of mosquitoes, how much more should we be concerned about them controlling the population of humanity? It should concern you that government even has a vote in such matters. But they have opinions as to whether or not you should have children, how many children you should have, and how easy it should be for you to eradicate those children. I do not want the clumsy hands of government getting into prenatal consultation with young mothers. Yet 12 states of our union are currently using taxpayer dollars to fund abortion and abortion providers. Abortion rates are nearly 3 times higher among Black Americans than white Americans. The racist ideals of Margaret Sanger are coming true before our very eyes. The book of Exodus is far more relevant than anything you read on social media. Well, what do we do in the midst of a land that has failed to remember so much and that is having a new reality forced upon us? Notice number 3, the faithful rebels. It says in verse 17, but the midwives, the healthcare sector, feared God. It did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the male children live. This may be the first instance of godly, civil disobedience anywhere in Scripture. But there is a time when government overreach becomes so clear that you must remember that ultimately you report to a higher power than any president or any senator or any elected official. These midwives knew there was a God in heaven. They saw obedience to Him as being a greater duty than obedience to the Pharaoh. Where did they gain such knowledge? We don't know for sure. Perhaps it was a conversation with a faithful Hebrew friend. Perhaps their mother taught them. But rest assured, it was not learned at the University of Cairo. Never underestimate the grassroots efforts of ordinary people having honest conversations about truth, reaching out to people who do not necessarily look like them, who do not vote like them, who do not pray like them, but just having a good, honest, not confrontation, but conversation. God knows we need more conversations than confrontations in this day. Someone had reached these ladies at the right time, and they were in Egypt for such a time as this, and they saved untold numbers of Hebrew children, and ultimately the Redeemer and the foreshadowing type of the Lord Jesus Christ in Moses. Verse 18, so the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, why have you done this and let the male children live? Now get this. I did some study on this. Literally, what Pharaoh was asking them to do is as the child was coming out of the birth canal, as soon as they could tell that the child was a male, they were to apply pressure to the back of the child's neck. I know this is hard to hear. I don't want to say this any more than you want to hear it. But they were to apply pressure to the back of the child's neck and cut off the carotid artery and cut off the blood flow to the brain until that baby died. It's what we call in our day partial birth abortion. The mother, for all they knew, this baby just didn't make it. Sometimes that happens. And she didn't know why it happened to her, and she would grieve the loss. But as far as she knew, it was just the course of nature. It was a policy that called for, that sanctioned the murder of babies in a way that did not look like the murder of babies. Anytime you want to bring about social change, the first thing you have to do is commandeer the dictionary. You have to take control of the language. Language can be used for good or for bad. You can, as it was said of Churchill when he gave his great speech at the turn of the World War II, they said, what has he just done? And they said, he has mobilized the English language and put it into military service. Well, you can mobilize language for good or for bad. And the goal of Pharaoh is to bring about a policy change that doesn't look like we're killing babies. But that is, in fact, what we're doing. And in the same way, you will see when you hear people talk about abortion, it seems so reasonable. It seems to make sense. There's 1,001 reasons why it makes sense. But it so glosses over ultimately what is happening. And what is happening is a human life is having its life sucked right out of the body. It's being snuffed out in its mother's womb, whether it's 6 weeks or whether it's 9 months. It's murder. It's murder. It's sanctified, it's cleaned up, it just seems like a policy, but it's not a policy, it's murder. It's exactly what Pharaoh is doing here early in the verses in the Exodus. The midwives refused. They said to Pharaoh, they said, well, I'll tell you what happened. You know, these Hebrew women, they're not like the Egyptian women. They're vigorous and they give birth before we get there. Pharaoh, I mean, it's one of these gals, one of these Hebrews that they cast as Wonder Woman. I mean, think about it. Gal Gadot, she's an Israeli. I mean, they're carrying like submachine guns at like 18, okay? They're drafted automatically into the military. They're not like us. They're different. They're cranking out babies left and right. I mean, it's just easy for them. They're having babies before we get there. Well, notice a few observations, even thus far in the text, 19 verses in. First of all, subtle change precedes open change. The first policy change was, let's just increase the workloads, hoping that we can snuff out some of the Hebrews from being born and being conceived in the first place. Then he conspired with the midwives for a covert operation. Nobody will know about it. Have we got any conspiracy theorists in the house? This one was true. This was a covert operation. Make the death of the boys look accidental and unintentional. But before he changed the law to sanction the murder, which is just about to happen, to sanction the murder of the male children, he called it a medical procedure. Kill the babies in a way that it doesn't look like you're killing the babies. Subtle change is preceded by open change. How many of you saw on the news this past week where a pastor in London was arrested for, as I read it, reading a verse of the Bible? Now, you know there's something about Europe is the muse of America. We're so fascinated with anything that they do. We want our health care to look like theirs. We hope that one day they will invite us to the popular kids' table and we can sit down and dine together as one of the world powers. And so anything they do, we want to do. So I look at Europe and then specifically London and the United Kingdom, and what happens in London typically follows here about 10 years. And so what we're seeing happen there now, I would see in the next 10 years, I could foresee, hopefully not in the state of Florida, but it will happen. It'll happen somewhere where a pastor, just literally for expositing the text or reading the passage of the Bible, if it's rightly understood, it will be interpreted as hate speech. You know it's coming. You know it's coming, and you got to make up your mind now what you're going to do when it happens. Are you going to stand with us, or are you going to watch us go away? You have to make up your mind before it gets here. I've got to make up my mind before it gets here. Am I going to try to gloss over it and act like it's not there? Or am I going to do what I've always done and just present the text as it is? Letter B. So letter A, a subtle change precedes open change. Letter B, race and gender issues have always been a battleground of the truth. The murder was limited to race and gender. Hebrew boys were to be taken. The lines were drawn there. Do not be surprised that the battleground for truth. Now listen very carefully. Don't let anyone on either side of the aisle change the conversation for you. It's not primarily political. It's primarily theological. When God created mankind, he created them with two genders. Now, you can change the plumbing all you want, but you will not change the chromosomes. There are two genders. It's a theological imperative. It is true. And there's one race. The amount of melanin that is in the skin makes us look a little different one from another. But ultimately, whether you're talking to the most conservative theologian or whether you're talking to the most liberal geneticist, They all agree, every one of you and all of those watching online came forth from a single human ancestor. That's without any disagreement. We're all on the same page on that one. However, so many are trying to get us to fight as if we are so radically different one from another. Allow your theology to affect your worldview so that whatever is being screamed at you from whatever corner, you look at the world through theological lenses. Letter C, recognize that God rewards godly civil disobedience. In verse 20, it says, so God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. And Pharaoh commanded all of his people. Now here's where the policy ultimately crossed the line for God. He commanded all the people of Egypt, every son that is born to the Hebrews, you shall cast into the Nile. This was ultimately an act of worship. But you shall let every daughter live. It's national policy. You got a neighbor that's a Jew. Find out if they have a little boy or a little girl. And you have the freedom, if you recognize that this ethnic people group has a baby boy, to take that boy from them and drown them in the Nile River. As a matter of fact, it's your civic duty to do so. Open change preceded by subtle change. This great social experiment of population control has reached its ultimate purpose. But all the while, in the background, God is raising up a deliverer. One of my guys here in the church, you know, there's something about living here in Nassau County. I make it a little bright. North Florida, it's what some people call South Georgia, you know. It's a unique place on the planet. You know, I feel like we've preserved some things that maybe have been lost in some other areas. But so many of us, we talk to each other, and we might, you know, we might make a decision a little different here or there, but generally, we see the world the same. And I was talking to one of my guys. He called me a couple nights ago. He's probably watching. He's in Atlanta now, and he's probably watching online. You know who I'm talking about if you're watching. And he said, Pastor, pray for me. He said, my blood pressure's through the roof. I really need to calm down. He says, the doctors tell me that I need to calm down. And I said, well, what's got you so worked up? He said, I watch the news. He said, and I know it shouldn't get to me, but I just watch the news and I'm getting so upset for my grandchildren, he said. And it's not funny, but I kind of laughed, and because I've been there. How many of you have ever thrown anything at your TV? Have you ever been there? It doesn't help any, but it makes you feel a little bit better, doesn't it, sometimes? But so he says, I'm watching the news, and my blood pressure's going up, and it's really getting to me, and I'm riding around listening to talk radio, and it's just, man, I'm just telling you, it's really having an effect. Here's what a Christian has to always remember, is in the darkest days, politically, God is always working behind the scenes. And he's always raising up a deliverer. Look at chapter 2, verse 1, and we're going to end here. It says, now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son. She saw that he was a fine child, and she hid him for 3 months. A little baby that we don't have a record of what happened during those 3 months. All we know is that history calls his name Moses. God is hearing the cries of his people, and he's putting his hand on a baby boy. While the eyes of the world were fixed on Pharaoh's palace there in Cairo, over in the land of Goshen, a baby cries. While the eyes of the world were fixed on the city of Rome, over in the land of Bethlehem, a baby cries. And who knows what God is doing today in the midst of our land? We can know this. We're told in the book of Deuteronomy that ultimately he's going to send another like Moses. Oh, you know of his first advent, the Lord Jesus Christ. But at his second advent, he is coming as the ultimate, capital R, Redeemer. But he's unlike Moses in some ways. He is the final, decisive rescuer, savior, deliverer. He is the ultimate one. He too barely escaped the slaughter of the innocents in Bethlehem. He lived a perfect life. He died for sinners and he rose again. But there are major differences between him and his prototype Moses. For you see, Moses saw the world as us and them, the oppressed and the oppressor. The Lord Jesus Christ comes to rescue, redeem, and set free both the oppressed and the oppressor. Moses delivered the hated race. The Lord Jesus Christ came to save both the hated and the hater. Moses could not deliver the strangled babies or those thrown into the Nile. But the Lord Jesus Christ can save the babies, the mothers, the abortion providers, the irresponsible boyfriends. He loves and saves any sinner who will trust him. So if you are one of Christ's people, do not look at the world as good guys versus bad guys. Learn to see the world as a glorious mission field. And no matter what their stripe, that when Jesus Christ suffered and bled and died on the cross, he died for the people that you tweet about, that you comment about. The Lord Jesus Christ died for the people who cause your blood pressure to go up. He does not call you to agree with them. He doesn't say that you shouldn't speak against them. The church maintains its prophetic voice. As John the Baptist called out Herod, you can call out political leaders, but you never forget that Jesus came to save Herod, not condemn Herod. You remember that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming again, that the day is coming when everything as it is will be made new, and it will not be divided along racial lines or ethnic lines. It will be those who trust and those who don't. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. With heads bowed and eyes closed, there's a beautiful psalm. We're reminded to pay homage to the Son while there is time. It seems to communicate that there's a time when you won't be able to. But today you're able to. You're able to pay homage to the Son, to receive Him, to bow before Him, to recognize Him as your Savior, as your King, to own Him as your God. If you're under the sound of my voice and that's not happened for you, now I don't mean your parents, your parents did. As many of us, our parents dedicated us as children. And that was a good and godly thing. But when you stand before the living God, He will not ask you what your parents' opinion of Him was. He will say, did you trust me with your soul? not knowing what you were doing, as a consenting adult, did you say, I choose Christ? If it hasn't happened today, it could happen for you. In just a moment, our pastors are going to make their way here to the front. If you're here and you're not sure where you stand with God, let me invite you to come and settle that today. Perhaps you're here and like some in our first service that would just say, you know, God has always worked amongst tribes, and we should be a part of a Bible-believing church, a Bible-believing tribe. And today, God is calling us to unite with this family of faith. If that's the case for you, in just a moment, as soon as I say amen to this prayer, you step out and come and let one of our pastors know you would like to join. We would be thrilled that God's leading you here. I'm going to pray a short prayer. You ask God what He would have you to do, and then obey. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank You, Lord, for Your Word. I can't imagine it being any more relevant or true to life. Father, this ancient book is so contemporary. Help us to trust You, Lord, and not look for answers on social media or Google for all of our answers, but Lord, look to Your Word. Your Word is truth. And see a commentary on our own culture. Help us to believe it and show us how we should respond. For those that need to be saved or joined, give them courage. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come if God's drawing. If you'll remain standing just for a moment. Peter and Heather Hansen, if you would make your way forward. They're joining us today. Are they in this service with us? Here they are. You guys come on down. Peter and Heather have answered the call to do missions primarily in Europe. So they're going to be going here in the next few months. They're currently raising support and getting that prayer foundation and just building relationships here in the States with various churches, and they're about to go to Europe. So I want you to meet them. They're going to make their way back in just a moment to a table out to my right and your left, just outside in the lobby. So stop by and get some information from them. If you want to hear more about their story, you can go to the Maximum Life podcast at zachterry.org, and we did an hour interview with them and just found out exactly what all they're doing. The thing I love about it is they're taking skills that that they would just use here in the States. Videographers, storytellers, shooting documentary-type videos, and going with some 80-some-odd missionaries and telling their story back here in the States. So that they can raise support and get more people rallying around them. So stop by. You guys can go ahead. Julie, would you lead them on out and make your way back to the front? And Dan, if you would come. Dan can come and close us out however he sees fit. Thanks,
brother. Thank you, Pastor. Amen, church. We certainly have a lot to celebrate today. Just let me quickly remind you, this week, our midweek service is going to look a little bit different. We are not going to meet on Wednesday night. That means if you come up here, the doors will be locked and the lights will be off. Instead, we are going to come together on Thursday night, and we're going to have a special joint service. We're going to invite our youth in and some of the other churches in the community and just pray for our nation, pray for our churches, pray for our schools, pray for our communities. And we just want to encourage you to be a part of that. Also, church, I get today to be the bearer of some really good news. When we bought this property and built this property in 2007, we spent about $10.1 million. That's how much debt we accrued when we were able to build and come in here. Over the years, of course, we've strived to pay that down. In 2017, right before Pastor came, we still owed about $7 million on this debt. Well, as of last week, just 4 years later, the debt is now $995,000. Amen. It's only through God's hand and your generosity that we're able to make those kinds of announcements. And it is just because of your faithful giving. Even though the world around us has had a rough year, you guys have done a fantastic job of just lifting up this church and making sure that this church will be a lighthouse for generations and generations to come. Also, church, next week, men, next week is Mother's Day. Don't forget, it's Mother's Day. We want to do something special as a part of our services. So if you have any pictures of you and mom or mom and kids and want to send those to the church, we want to integrate that into part of our worship service next Sunday. Mothers, we're going to have a special day. We're going to have a gift for you. And we really want you to just round up the whole family and bring them out for Mother's Day. Amen. Church, let's pray, then we'll be dismissed together. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, again, we just praise you and thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing in and through this church. Thank you, Lord, that we have a lot to celebrate. Lord, I pray that as we leave this place, that we will take the truths that we learned today and apply them to our lives and share them with those around us. Lord, again, we just love you and praise you. Thank you, Lord, for providing for us in so many great and amazing ways. Lord, use us as we leave this place to spread your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.